Because it's such a diversity of subjects. So before I start, I want each of you on the panel to think about a question for another panel member, because I think all of you guys cross different areas, and I think probably would like to learn something about something that someone else does. Kapil, you haven't had a chance to speak yet, so of course everybody knows AWS. I think we'd love to hear about your background and what your role at AWS is, and why would AWS be here at a blockchain meetup?
Well, lots of questions there. So my name is Kapil Chhabra. I'm a product manager in AWS. I run the Kinesis business, and Kinesis is a real-time streaming application that's available on AWS. My focus is to enable machine learning, especially the unsupervised machine learning, in real time on the AWS use cases that customers use us for. Why am I here? I think it's important to bring in different perspectives if you want to have a good, healthy panel. And I'm here to bring in the perspective of what cloud is today and how AWS can potentially enable some of the use cases that we're all talking about with blockchain.
Great, thank you. Okay, well, let's continue down the line, because each of you talked a bit about your companies, but you know, stories of how people got involved and what they're doing are always memorable. And so, Karen, I'd love to hear, you know, what were you doing before? How did you end up doing this?
Yeah, sure. So I actually have a half joking, half real question for Kapil here. So BlockCypher, we use our tagline as we are like Amazon Web Services for blockchain. So my question for you is, what do you think about that? And what are you doing about it? So that's my half joking, half real question. Back to your question, Bill. So I have been working in enterprise software for a really long time, and one of the areas I worked on was payments and worked with Swift. How many prefer Swift here? Okay. So about 6 years ago, 8 years ago, I was working with Swift, and I thought, my gosh, this beats disrupting. And so at that time, there really wasn't, other than Bitcoin coming out, there wasn't really any movement around the kind of disruption that we're seeing today. So when I finally understood the blockchain and the technology behind Bitcoin and all the cryptocurrencies, I just said, this is that up. So join BlockCypher and have them back.
So I got into blockchain like a lot of people first did in around 2013. The price was going up, and I was like, I should mine some coins. I can get free money by doing this, right? So I started mining Litecoin, and then the price crashed, and I stopped buying Litecoin. And then I actually looked into learning more about some of the, what cryptocurrencies were, and actually started investing into Bitcoin, and then discovered that Bitcoin can be used to place bets on sporting events. And I was living in Indiana, working at a networking company at the time where we couldn't bet, so I kept using my Bitcoins to bet against LeBron in the Eastern Conference Finals. When they were playing against the Heat against the Pacers, and needless to say, LeBron won, and I lost all my Bitcoin. But then more recently, I've gotten involved. My background's in networking. I worked in distributed systems for a long time, trusted hardware, and the security paradigms involved with the decentralized computing movement are really compelling value propositions. So they didn't really appeal to me in that sense, and we set off to build kind of distributed infrastructure on Ethereum for companies in the name of security, and then we realized that none of the test apps that we built could actually run today because of things like the gas block limit. And so I started getting more involved with the community to try to do what I can to help things scale, and TrueBit was a scalability solution, and I met the team, and with the power of open source software, we really collaborate and contribute to do that. So one of my questions is, for Chris from Gollum, people can cheat to try and earn their computation rewards. How can you guys potentially use TrueBit to help
of song.
Can you hear me, guys? Does this work?
Yes.
Yeah, it's a very good question, and we arrived like half an hour before the meetup started, and we were sitting in the Kupa Cafe downstairs, and we were just reading through your new announcements. And what Vukash said to me, Vukash is one of our core developers in the RealSmart guy. It's like, wow, we can use this step, right, to solve a lot of things, right? Because people are like, oh, we need to make new product that is going to be about resisting crawls on Mars or something, right? Something that is like 20 years away, and like a lot of stuff isn't solved on the layer one, layer two infrastructure, right? And we have to solve a lot of that. So we should chat later. And yes, there is room for a lot of cooperation, right? So to segue to my backstory, I joined the blockchain space because I was feeling the energy that Bill was talking about, like so many people are getting together and being excited about building something totally new, right? Like the get rich quick schemes, I think this is gonna end in tears, right? But people are solving really big problems, like really, really complex ones that are like, well, it's not that you just need the like half a year of five developers and you're gonna have it. Like it's like you have to solve like 10 PhD theses to like make it work, right? And this is like, I think this is very similar to Bell Labs back in the day maybe, right? And I think this is very interesting. For me, the most interesting part, like I like Bitcoin. I think it's doing it's obviously doing super well. I think it's good for a lot of things. But I personally love the Ethereum space. I think this is what really captures my mind. We have this global computer that can do a lot of things, right? Not only store value, but also run a lot of different things. This is the most interesting part for me, and this is small part of that is being solved by Go. Yeah. And my question to you is, when will my wallet arrive? No, because your product is so high quality and in such high demand that it's actually, I always see that, yeah, we're going to ship into the 2 weeks or something like that. So my question is really a hidden kudos to you.
Yeah. Thanks. So yeah, should arrive soon, so we managed to clear the backlog. It was a lot of demand. Well, we follow basically the price of crypto as the value of the token grow. You spend more time securing it, so
yeah,
we had a lot of demand in the last few months. But yeah, back to the story around crypto. I think I started to hear about Bitcoin in maybe late 2012, and it's actually through Silk Road. So I don't know if you remember that online. So I'm not saying I bought some bread. But it's just that there was this news, and I said, oh, they must have found a way to transfer some value in a censorship-resistant way. That's kind of a big deal, you know, to be able to sell the transaction without a third party of trust. And I was like, oh, that must be kind of interesting. So I started to dig into the technology, and you get struck by the technology. By at the beginning, it was really mostly about Bitcoin and the first implementation of that technology. And yeah, the energy has been always very, very strong early days with Bitcoin, and the Ethereum community has been extremely thriving as well. There's such a number of projects. I guess unfortunately there's 90% of ICOs and decentralized applications that are either scammed or scams to be, but there's a very valuable application that can definitely be really changing for a lot of things that will happen. And we are very humble and pragmatic in providing like some tools to make this ecosystem more secure on the edge of the network. So initially for cryptocurrencies, but we're very, very bullish on the decentralized application that are being built out there. And I guess that we're very bullish about the fact that users are more empowered to have their keys, and we want to provide the right tools for people to own their keys. So we're really like user oriented. There's some interesting things around enterprise stuff, but the user side of this blockchain is also about the users, about decentralization,
Guru must not forget that.
Thomas, before you hand away the mic, okay, so you know you're in an interesting position having started with Bitcoin, really, and then watching, I think, the explosion of all the different types of coins, and you now service Ethereum, the ERC20 tokens, and all that sort of stuff. Do you have, and so when you see something coming, or when the market is faced with one of these forks or splits, what do you guys see in terms of, you know, is there a lot of activity from your customers asking you to support this or that, and do you have a sense of what tokens are going to take off before they take off?
So there are some signals for sure, but the good thing for you is that it's everything is very public. So we've got like a public roadmap. You just go on legend.wallet.com/roadmap, and you've got like a Trello, and you've got like people vote for support for whatever coin. There's some weak signals, but that you can. So I guess for the Merkle, it can be some interesting insights for hedge funds is to have a look at our roadmap and what people are requesting. It's true that every time there's a fork, we see a lot of people, like our sales go up because people understand that to get the full extent of the fork, well, you need to own your keys. Owning your keys is complicated, and people refer to Ledger, so we see like these kind of trends. As soon as there's an event where you actually need to own the keys, we definitely see that.
Thank you. And Karen, so you guys, of course, are a bit of an abstraction layer on top of the main chains till the applications run. Is the forking and the kind of, I don't know, confusion or consensus or lack of consensus, does that affect your operations at all, or you just kind of pick a few? Like, what's your team's approach to which chains does your abstraction layer support?
And so we go by market adoption. We look at volume, and we also talk to our customers. So with Bitcoin, obviously we are supporting all the major forks there, and every time there is a fork and we need to update our community, we do so through various channels, number of channels, and so we're just very close to where people are going, how they're using the different blockchains.
Do you have enough, you're out there talking to customers, and I don't know if you've surveyed them in a formal way or not, or just are picking up on noise, but I'm curious the market's reaction to what's just happened on the Bitcoin versus Bitcoin Cash fork, or whatever you want to call it. Like, yeah. Your customers, is there a group think in your customer base about where they want you to go?
So no, I don't think there's a group thing, but there is a large contingent that wants support for Bitcoin Cash. I mean, that's very clear. The value is there now. We see that. So there are a number of people who asked about that initially, but then have laid off, right?
Okay.
And so that's the very interesting thing about this, about the blockchain. It's decentralized, and so there are a lot of people around the world, and there are a lot of trends you can start to see that are consumer-based. And those trends that are consumer-based are driving payment processors to get involved, right? Which payment processors, they really have to do this, but it's because their merchants and their consumers, particularly their international consumers, are asking them, I need Bitcoin, or I need Dash, because I don't want to deal with currency fluctuations, and I don't want to deal with the wait times of having to wait for Western Union, wherever I am. So these end users in the end are driving a lot of change, and their voices are being heard.
So there was momentum a little bit for Bitcoin Cash, maybe falling off, but it's still there. What was the momentum like for Segwit 2x in your customer base?
Yes.
And does that still exist or not?
So there was momentum for Segwit 2x, and there are some companies that were very vocal about it, right? And that would have made a big difference in scalability and performance. And I mean, you can just see now from the price of Bitcoin, right? It was very high and went down and sort of, post or dashed in some way. But this highlights this forking and this sort of disagreement in the blockchain. It just shows that there are many different governance models, right? So Bitcoin is just one example. Ethereum has another one. Dash has another one. And so what I'd like to say is, ask people, how many of you know about Dash's governance model? Okay, a few. So Dash is a different model. They put aside 10% of every transaction and put it into a treasury. And that treasury then is used to fund further development of the blockchain, as well as business development and other development, you know, of the network. Now, if you think about that, and this is why so many of us are excited about blockchain, because we're effectively able to create, you know, these new markets and sustain these new markets, because we not only have the technology, but we have the funds and we have a group getting together that policy. So I'd say yes, Bitcoin is one example, but you know, there's a number of other blockchains to look at too.
And on that note, Trubit, so Mo, you're not working specifically on the governance of Ethereum per se, but it sounds like what you guys have is sort of a model for governance of a different sort. Do you guys have an opinion on proof of stake upcoming in Ethereum? Does that affect you guys at all? Or yeah, just general thoughts on that?
So proof of stake is certainly going to be a major solution for helping scale Ethereum, but it's quite a ways out. Probably approximately another 18 months for what they call the Casper protocol to come out. It's also never really been tested at a big scale, so it's going to eventually be. But in any case, the Trubit protocol would still apply, because there's still going to be a concept of gas, and whereas there's not going to be no longer a kind of blocking limitation, it's still going to be a cost. So at that point, where Trubit will continue delivering value to the community will be to be able to do large amounts of computation for even lower gas costs off of the blockchain. So the throughput of Ethereum will certainly increase, so will the demand, but you know, for really complicated applications, data processing, video rendering, artificial intelligence, there's certainly going to be a large demand for off-chain computation still for things like Trubit. Yeah.
Let me turn that back to Kapil. Okay, so you know, obviously you're not going to probably represent a unified view for all of AWS, of course, because you're working on certain things there. But is there a way you can describe, I guess, what applications in the distributed blockchain world, when you see things like Gollum, you see things like storage, you see things like Filecoin, do they make sense to you? And if not, or if they do, are there applications where you think, you know, it actually does kind of make sense that they should run it, like that there's a better story potentially for certain applications outside of the US? Or do you think the architecture and the latency is never important? Love to hear kind of a big picture.
That was a loaded question. let me split it up into two different parts. The first part, I think what's really critical that blockchain brings is the notion of trust. And that's really critical for a lot of use cases. But this whole space of computing in general, centralized, decentralized, or distributed, or whichever way you want to call it, it's a huge market opportunity for all of us. In the fullness of time, I believe this personally, and AWS as a whole, we believe that companies will not have their own data centers. And what they will do is use compute power, storage power, networking power from other distributed ways. This could be through the cloud, through the blockchain, or any other way that that's invented way down the line. So what this means is that overall, when companies look for some value that they are trying to achieve in a decentralized or a distributed way, they would reach out to all of these different forms of providers. AWS would be one of those. It's not a winner-take-all market, in my opinion. It's important to look at why customers choose a cloud offering and AWS, for instance. And there are things like security and reliability that are table stakes. They are the topmost priority for the customers and topmost priority for us at AWS as well. The other reasons why customers adopt things like cloud and AWS, and that may be relevant for most of you here, is the agility at which they can go ahead and spin up new resources and build a new thing. I, in an organization, want 10 GPUs now to build a new machine learning model that could find very useful. In the traditional model, these companies would have to wait for a few weeks until those resources are available and they can do something with it. In the cloud model, it's available within minutes. 10 GPUs, okay, that's pretty simple. You have that agility. The second reason is the breadth of services that AWS offers. There are currently 90 plus services, and customers come in and use those services in various different forms. The third reason is cost. Where unutilized or underutilized capacity is not going wasted. So there's a lot of cost savings that can be utilized with by moving to a decentralized and distributed infrastructure. The fourth reason is being able to deploy all over the world in just minutes. With that comes the elasticity and scalability for things like, I'll give you an example, an internal example for us, which is Amazon.com, which is a customer of AWS, and they need to scale up and down based on the demands. July, we had the Prime Day, and now Black Friday is coming up, and the demand for infrastructure for Amazon.com goes up drastically. And with the cloud, with AWS, all of that is possible.
Great. Chris, I love your thoughts on application spaces where you guys are just killer, and then also because you did an early ICO, I love your kind of observations on your own token. Not that you had expectations, but just, you know, what's the story of how your ICO and the token has played out? Is it getting used much, you know, relative to expectations, and what's the profile of the customer using it actually in the real marketplace as opposed to just speculation?
Sure. So, first, commenting on the use cases, the existing infrastructure like AWS for the distributed computing is very impressive, right? Like we've been at it for many years, and the ability to just, you know, spin it. I use it. We use it a lot, right? It works incredibly well. And I think for the decentralized computing, these are very early days. And it's like 5 to 10 years behind. Like, this is my opinion. Before you will have half of that reliability and simplicity of these and things like that. For some use cases, it will make sense. For some use cases, it will not make sense. For some use cases, only having a lot of your GPUs in one room and owning your own HPC will make sense, right? And the market will decide which use cases are better for what. So that's my take on that. I think it's a really cool thing that a lot of you in this room that could not, like I couldn't afford HPC and just build out my own computing center, will have alternative to, like, maybe I don't want to just go to a bunch of big companies, maybe I want to do it in totally decentralized. For many reasons, it could be many reasons. It would also not make sense for it, because things like AWS are good for like so many use cases, and will always be better for a lot. And now going to the target. So our Golem ICO was in November 2016, so very early on. It was a modest ICO. The founder, the CEO, he knew together with three other founders that it could have been way bigger. But they put a cap on it. The cap was $8 million, and the whole sum was funded in 19 minutes, which was basically as fast as it could have went through your network at the time, right? So it probably would have been even faster, if not for the bandwidth. It went pretty well. Ether was at $10 back then, so it's we have a good runway. we have this decent runway. So we're looking forward to the market correction after all these stupid ICOs that you mentioned, right? And I think our first the rendering thing, the brass version of Golem in life in Q1 of 2018 on mainnet, and then I will be able to tell you how it behaves in real world. For now, yes, it's a lot of speculation. We have a lot of whale holders. We know we have Polychain on board and a couple of other people who are long on Golem and are just following it for when it becomes when it comes to use, and the price will go up a lot. And it goes up when we communicate with our community better, right? And I think what's really important is that you don't go into hiding. Like, you can do good or bad things in hiding, I know, like a post your ICO, but we have a very good cadence of releasing the blog post about, like, what are we doing on the technical side, like, and discussing with community, like, hey, this is what we're doing, this is a movie about it, this is a blog post about it, like, what do you think about it, what are the doubts, can we answer them in any way? So that's and like in March, April 2018, we can meet again and we'll tell you like how it behaves exactly, right? I think it will be crazy.
Okay. We'll open it up for questions from the audience for just a minute, but if any of you, you don't have to, have a burning question for another panelist, ask it in a second, but I also want each of you, and you may not have an answer for this either, if you had to pick like 5 years from now, is there a token out there that you think, you know what, if they execute well, I should have had that? Okay, so hold that thought, but if you have a burning question for another panelist, ask that, and then at the end we'll move into token questions and we'll take bodies. Anybody have a question for each other?
Maybe a question for all. You know, we'd love to connect with some people at AWS who offer some cloud HSM offering and provide that for all. Have the blockchain key management on the HSM with some computer, to have some chat on that.
Absolutely, we will look into it. That's why I'm here, as I said, to show how AWS is an enabler for blockchain and similar technologies and hash looking.
Sure. Okay, now, I don't know if any of you look at all these token things, but if, no, and these are not necessarily recommendations, right?
No, we're not qualified. This is not advice.
Yeah, any tokens and business models that any of you guys think, wow, like I love that business model. If that thing actually executes.
So I have talked to others called OmniLabs. And anybody here know about OmniLabs? Oh, okay, there you go. All right, so anyway, so they have an interesting model or idea out there. And that is for building a community for robots, more quickly and scalably. And so the idea is to create a utility token that robotics developers can use to pay more fund for services producing robotics, and really encourage this co-development for robotics that can be very costly, but can also be better done if it's done globally and shared. Sort of
collaboratively
done around the world. So I thought that was interesting.
So in our pursuit to, we were working with GitHub actually to initially do some decentralized security infrastructure, and we built these DApps and realized it didn't really scale. So in our pursuit, 2 points on that actually. In Silicon Valley, this comes up against AWS, when you're kind of, everyone, there's a lot of smart engineers here and they all understand the value prop decentralization, and once you talk to them about it, they're like, all right, let's move. You know, like 6 weeks, let's move to POC. And you really gotta slow them down, which is kind of unfortunate because this space in the open source world, this whole, the bad news is internet of value and bugs are so costly. You can't really move that fast. So depending on your application and the cadence and how fast you release features, I think AWS certainly is something that I'm not able to compete against. But in exploring a solution for blockchains, Bill mentioned this proof of stake, which isn't available yet, we found proof of authority, which is not a fully decentralized blockchain, but it is a what they call it, a permission chain. So some of these other blockchains, like that we were talking about before, some people asked if people have heard of Hyperledger, or even JP Morgan has one called Quorum, which is going to be open source, so that's good, but we all kind of rolled our eyes at the beginning about that. So when it comes to near-term scalability, I think these sort of hybrid proof of authority chains could have a lot of potential. We've looked into that, where in the near term, you at least build the app and start getting the app, right? And for a lot of these ICOs in the business context, they'll be able to, raise a lot of money, they'll actually be able to launch their DApp and start building out, start kind of getting early traction and building out their network effect in the near term. Just kind of based on a permission network where we're already used to accepting, a long end user licensing agreement. So you just kind of accept the terms that this is a chain ran by a group of companies or people or something, but your blockchain app is actually usable. So that's one of the neutral things that I'm looking at.
So the question is still about the talkback status.
Yes, sir. Anything.
So obviously I'm long gone, because I invest most of my awake hours in. Except for that, I sold all my Bitcoin, and I bought even more ETH, right? This is what I'm long on, because there are many fundamental problems that are not solved yet, right? And I think Ethereum as a community, as an ecosystem, after the DevCon happened, which happened a couple of weeks, one week ago, I can say that I cannot give you the details here, but in December and in January, we'll hear big announcements that that will really make it clear like how Ethereum ecosystem and community are getting its shit together and just solving all the fundamental problems that other ecosystems haven't solved yet. Ethereum haven't solved them yet. But once it's solved, like it really speeds up the development of things that you build on top of that. So that's the ecosystem I'm betting on.
Yes, I'm quite bullish on a lot of different protocols, so I'm still very bullish on Bitcoin, and I think Bitcoin proves with its inability to change, it's actually an incredible value. The fact that it's very hard to actually move, and just the fact to change from 1 megabyte to 2 megabyte is something like impossible to do, and I think that's actually a very good thing, so that it's something that even though it's been constantly attacked, it cannot change. This inability to change is actually very valuable. And for the other platform, Ethereum, obviously, I'm very bullish as well. But on the apps built on top of that, I'm always bullish on what cannot be done in a normal world. So there was this example of a Silk Road, well, with Bitcoin, you could buy for something like without a third party. So that was pretty powerful, and I think there's some other use cases that are always a bit borderline, but it's not illegal, it's maybe immoral, but around things that cannot be done without the blockchain. I think like prediction market, there's a real need to transfer knowledge and to monetize this knowledge and free flow of information. So I think there's a bunch of companies working on stuff like that, like Gnosis and Audio, or some of them. Decentralized exchanges are also kind of interesting. There's a need to transfer from a token to another, but you never know what's going to happen, how these tokens are going to be treated. If it's a securities, there will be a lot of shutdowns in exchanges. In some countries, it's illegal to have these kind of tokens. With a decentralized exchange, you don't really care. Just ask, they're not going to shut down a smart contract. So it will solve actually a very big problem. So I'm always looking at some actual real needs that there are in the community, and there's no solution, a centralized solution that exists, and for this kind of problem, like decentralized applications are very, very useful, yes.
Great, okay, so let's do three questions from the audience, and then these guys will be around for a bit after, if you want to do that. So, a hand right there?
Yeah. I'm really passionate about blockchain, but I do have a lot of concerns. So I'm passionate about blockchain first, but I do have some concerns. And and I would like to get your thoughts on the regulatory challenges and also the technical challenge. So on the regulatory front, we know that, you know, some countries already said we block that. For example, China has blocked Bitcoin, and we must name such as JP Morgan, Jamie Dimon call Bitcoin a fraud. And but they are also working on blockchain technology. So I would like to hear thoughts on from on regulatory, but also on the technical side, is you know, there's a lot of assumptions that over here that have not convinced me yet. For example, is you can pretty much, if you can get 50%, 51% of the network, then you can compromise the system. And this is not like compromising the bank. Because when you compromise the digital currency, everything becomes worthless. I understand it's very challenging to get 51% of the network to all participate at the same time, but that is a potential huge risk. And you know, when you go to a bank and there's deposit insurance, FDIC, that you know your money, that government's backing that, but as a, you know, average person, how do you get them to trust Bitcoin or any other currency?
Yes, I'll just say a couple of things, and then I'm sure the rest of the panel will weigh in. So, Jamie Dimon, okay, the day that he made that point, his company bought a whole bunch of Bitcoin. So, guess what? You want to know why he did that? So, that's what I say about Jamie Dimon. Now, in terms of regulatory issues, right, Japan and all those other countries, but definitely Japan is on the forefront. China, why do they do that? China wants to have control, right? China wants to come out with their own coin. I mean, we all know that China's central bank has been talking to all of the Bitcoin, all the blockchain leaders for years. They know exactly how the blockchain works. They're going to come with their own coin. They don't want any competition, right? Who would? Especially if you're China. You don't want any competition. So I'd say the countries that get it, you know, that can see the economic benefits and the values, they're doing something about it and they're going to get ahead. Right? Yes, there are going to be challenges. There's challenges with everything. There's risk with everything, right? And I definitely say we aren't working with US Department of Homeland Security for no reason, right? I mean, they get that yes, there are some issues around security, but Bitcoin is pseudonymous, okay? I mean, you can figure out, if you want to, who delivered that transaction, who has that address. And that's also part of the privacy problem. So there's a double-edged sword to all of that. And cash is the worst. Cash is absolutely the worst in terms of being used in every type of drug transaction, any type of trafficking. I mean, it is the most used for criminal activity. So I think in terms of regulation, that just in terms of crime, just doesn't make sense. This argument doesn't hold up.
So we do need to get back to talking about banking the unbanked. Yeah, we're not going to be able to maybe necessarily compete with the guarantees that the trust I have in my JP Morgan Chase account can provide, but at the same time, you know, the great majority of the population of the world still relies on cash, and they don't have the FDIC, and if that cash gets stolen, it's irreversible, but all those other potential opportunities of, you know, removing corrupt middlemen, which is what they face, really presents a lot of the value of kind of becoming your own bank thanks to cryptography and cryptocurrency. So yeah, it's just different solutions for different markets, right?
Yeah, I think this was one of the first instances somebody from big banks lying to the US. So I mean the JP Morgan guy that talked about Bitcoin, right? So I think Karen said it very well, right? Like basically I agree with everything that he said. And I wanna add a little bit that countries are gonna try to block that, but like not all countries are gonna block that. So we're just gonna have money going from the countries that blocked that to the countries that didn't block that, and then the countries that blocked that are gonna be like, we want kind of like part of that money back, so we're going to unlock some of this stuff. So I think this is how it's going to play out in a 3-year perspective, right? Like US could also stand down on everything, right? And then lock a lot of stuff, right? But they know, like, they're smart guys. You know, they know that the tax revenue is going to go way down there. So I think they are planning pretty smart. And I think in 3 years perspective, like this is all going to be, well, okay, maybe 5 years perspective. I don't know what's going to happen, right? But in 3-5 years perspective, just gonna we're going to figure that out, right? And banks, I just really listen to banks. Like they are so losers. They are still in the lead, like JP Morgan is, I don't know what their market cap is, but they are for sure as much as Bitcoin. Right?
Top 10 in the US. Yeah.
So like they're still a big leader that we're talking about. That's also like 3 to 5 years.
Yeah, maybe one thing to add on the resilience of these cryptos or Bitcoin, Ethereum, all the cryptos are being under constant attacks. Like every day, people trying to block that. There's basically a canary of like $200 billion, bounty of $200 billion on this crypto. So people try to attack it, to test it, and so far so good, you know. And SegWit 2x is something kind of interesting. In where you say that there's like 80% of the miners plus 10 of the most funded companies out there in this space that say, let's do a change and change the consensus rule. What happens? Nothing happens. So it's actually like a good indicator that if you want to have something that sticks to the consensus rules, it's actually kind of good. And regarding like the insurance part, are people going to get their Bitcoin back and all that? I don't think like Bitcoin is going to replace the banks. It's not there to replace banks right now, and there's a lot of things that work well in the banking system. But if things go really bad, well, there would be a safety net with crypto, I guess, to have some model of trust to continue transacting. But it's going to replace the system if there's something really bad happening, I would say. But it would be something very bad that would drive to this shift. If that happens, there would be an infrastructure at least to stay alive.
Okay, another question.
Hi everyone. So I manage an institutional fund that invests in crypto, and we've been talking a lot today about infrastructure in the industry. And so we are waiting for this infrastructure to appear for institutional investors like ourselves, and there is none. So you know we've been waiting for a good custody solution for funds. I know that Ledger is working on something, so it's super helpful for us. Like there is no one from exchanges here, unfortunately, but exchanges are also not really ready for institutions to trade. Kraken suspended their advanced orders some time ago. And like, so what's your take about infrastructure and when these infrastructural products for institutions will finally arrive? Because it's really too hard to operate without it.
Yeah, exactly. So this question sums up the state of the ecosystem to show that we are like at the very, very, very early stage, and that there are some foundational elements of that infrastructure that are being built, but nothing is still around yet, and there will be a lot of things moving that still needs to be built. So on this institutional part, we're taking the work to build some piece of that puzzle and bringing some institutional grade solution to safeguard crypto assets and to have defined, definite governance model and how the funds can be accessed with the right set of certification to give confidence to the different stakeholders, the institution, the investors, the regulators, and to make all this mess a bit less messy. And this break, we want that to, I would say like Q2 2018, we have this available. We're starting pilot phase at the end of the year. Q1, a beta with another 20 institutions. So Q2 would be something where we hope to see some the solution up and running. I would say another 12-18 months to have like some tier one custodians to operate this kind of infrastructure and provide a custodianship for crypto assets. So we may take it. It changes. If you go to New York and meet with people there, you see that it's all buzzing and people are building some tools around crypto. You've got like CME that's building some futures tools. There's the entire financial stack that is being built as we speak.
for lending, for derivatives, for all that kind of stuff. It just takes time. And just your question showed that we are very, very early in this space. Exciting stuff.
Great. We'll do one more question right here, and then we'll turn it over to Louis after that.
Hey guys, my name's Ian. I'm a product manager at Intuit. I'd love to hear your thoughts on the sort of possibilities that will be available at the intersection of artificial intelligence and blockchains. So I imagine as AI and blockchain ecosystems mature, how will those technologies complement each other, and what sort of new experiences will that enable?
Yeah, so we're working on a bit of that. Starting with fraud, trying to identify on the blockchain what are behavioral patterns, right, for fraud. What are behavioral patterns for say a gambler versus a hacker versus someone who's doing ransomware or trafficking, right? Now you can extend that to not just fraud but to other types of behavior patterns, right? And with fraud you can come up with scores. But you can extend that to other areas, right? Where you're trying to understand, like, say, for where should we build our next network, and where can we be optimized? So yes, I mean, there's a lot of opportunity for using the blockchain and AI. But I have to say, first you need to have data, and the blockchain in all that it has so far is still, I say, back to what some of these other panelists have, still in infancy, still need more data.
Great. So why don't we cut it off? Oh, this question. Yeah, I say you should definitely speak in the field of work, and then after that we'll turn it over to Louis.
So yeah, there are multiple things for machine learning and artificial intelligence. The primary one, along with data, is the need for compute power. And what you're looking for is to get a lot of that compute and infrastructure for that. Now, it's early days for blockchain, but the potential still lies there in terms of being able to provide that unlimited compute, and you can train the model faster than you can potentially do it.
Great. Okay, Louis has a few closing comments. Let's give the panel a hand.